Welcome to Fredericksburg Mission, a podcast talking all things mental health and wellness in the Berg, brought to you by...
How do you shorten the time it takes to buy a car? Car buying just got easier. Pohanka365.com lets you complete as much or as little of the car buying process online. Pohanka365.com, car buying simplified. Anytime, anywhere.
Welcome to Fredericksburg Mission Podcast. My name is Angela Rivers, and I am the host of this podcast. I am here with April Burch from Cooking Autism, Inc., and she is the executive director. Thank you so much, April, for joining us today.
Thank you for having me. I'm always, always excited to come and speak with you.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, I am so thankful to have met you a few years ago through Tim Pohanka at the Christmas tree auction.
Yeah,
so
that was 2 years ago.
I know. Yeah. And I feel like things have grown so much in Fredericksburg since then.
Yeah, it really has.
We've really become such a great family, and I'm really appreciative of all you do for our community and for Fredericksburg.
Thank you for what you're doing for the community. I think this podcast is great, and I think that what you're doing with UMFS is vital and important to the area. So
thank you. Thank you so much. So for all the listeners, I'd love for you just to kick off this podcast by telling people what Cooking Autism is.
Sure. Yeah. I can always talk about Cooking Autism. It could be like a 5-hour podcast.
Let's go.
The very condensed version is Cooking Autism is a nonprofit in the Rappahannock area. And what we do is we provide life skills programs to children and adults that have neurological challenges. And what that means is we take a cooking program and we practice skills inside of this program that are important. Things like following directions, step-by-step directions, being able to advocate for someone, being able to practice cleanliness and socialization, communication. There's literally an endless list of things that we practice, and we are able to do this in a cooking setting. But what's even more interesting is that we take a lot of data, and we can look at each and every single one of our participants and hone in on their needs. So we're doing this beautiful life skills class, but we're able to really hone in on every single participant. And what we're finding is that there is a foundation that each one of these students are growing off of, and they're becoming stronger and more independent and really gaining confidence as we're doing this. So that is kind of the very, very small condensed version of what Cooking Autism does.
Yeah, but it's so important, you know, in young children or young adults to give them that confidence.
Yeah, absolutely. And in the autism community, sometimes those life skills are extremely hard to pick up. It's not something that comes very easy to a lot of our children and adults. It takes a lot of practice. So that is where we come into play, is these repetitive classes over and over. We can change them up many times over, but the core of it is still there. And we're really excited to be able to offer that to our community members.
Yeah. And how long has Cooking Autism been operating for?
Sure. So we are hitting our 3rd year anniversary as a nonprofit. Prior to that, a team of educators built the program about 9 or 10 years ago. And they've been utilizing this program in their classroom for years before I was even introduced to it. And so very long story short, we asked them to partner with us to start a nonprofit, and they did. So we're utilizing their skills, their education, and we are able to offer it to other people in the area.
So why were you interested in being a part of it?
I have two amazing boys. Both are on the autism spectrum, both with ADHD and anxiety. And those boys, one of which, my youngest, his name is Daniel, he was always developmentally delayed. And from he didn't really speak until about kindergarten, and he didn't walk or crawl for a very long time. So he went through a beautiful, amazing pre-K program. And after pre-K, he was put into kindergarten, and his special education program there had this this life skills program. So we got to see kind of like magic start to happen in his kindergarten year. He started wanting to communicate and socialize, and he wanted to grow. And we were watching this growth happen and wondering where it could be coming from, because teachers are magical in any way.
They really are.
but we saw this growth happening, and then found out that he was participating in this life skills program. So I volunteered one day in this life skills program, and I kind of got to see like what was happening. And I overheard one teacher say to another teacher that they are running out of funds for that program. And so that is the beginning of where our nonprofit came from. We saw the need and we attacked it and decided other people needed to have this program like our son. So that is why I'm so interested and so vested in Cooking Autism, because I really believe in giving every child an opportunity for growth. And if that means in our autism community, something like that, they need something like this, then we're going to provide it. So.
And when your son was diagnosed, was that hard for you?
Oh, yeah. So Danny's my youngest. My oldest is Hunter. Danny was diagnosed probably about 3 years of age, but he was pretty behind. I have a wonderful, wonderful friend. Her name is Sarah, and she was watching him, and she has a nephew that is on the autism spectrum. And she looked at me one day and she said, look, Danny is 2 years old and he's not walking. He's barely crawling at this point. I think maybe that you should get him over for some testing, because he's developmentally behind his peers, and it's good to catch them early to see if they can get support for these sort of things. Nobody ever said the word autism at that point. It was just, your child's delayed. And at first I was like, oh wow, maybe my son is delayed, because we kept hearing the term late bloomer.
You hear that a lot with boys too.
A lot, yeah, because everybody grows differently. Mm-hmm. So we took him to Child Find, which is run by the state, and a lot, you'll find it with a lot of education, and they did some testing and they said he is developmentally delayed, and you should take him to see a developmental pediatrician. And so we did. We took him to VCU, which was amazing. Mm-hmm. They are fantastic. And VCU when you get a diagnosis of autism, it takes months and months and months of testing and going back and appointments. And when they called me and said, we're ready for a diagnosis, come on in and come visit with us. I brought him in to VCU, and they said, okay, he's developmentally delayed. We believe that he is on the autism spectrum, and their chances are he will not speak. Chances are he will be delayed significantly. And at that point, they kind of said high functioning, low functioning. They were giving a bunch of information. But at that point, my brain kind of shut off. So it took me, I cried for about 2 days. It took me about 2 days to really grasp what they were saying. And then my mother called me and she said, you have a diagnosis now. Now you can move forward and figure out how to help your kiddo. And if anybody in the world could be a mom of somebody with autism, you're the right person.
Yeah.
And it took that.
I could have told you that.
it took just those nice, kind words for me to snap out of it and start moving forward. And now we've been hustling and moving forward ever since. I'll do anything to support my kiddos, with both of them, with their diagnosis. But it's kind of shocking when you first get a diagnosis, because you kind of grieve a little bit for the life you thought your kiddo should be having. That special, beautiful, perfect scenario of what their life would look like, you've lost it as soon as they've given you that diagnosis. But the good news is that my perception of what that was is totally different now. Mm-hmm. And every day it's more and more exciting of what his abilities and what both of their abilities are. But anyway, it's it's shocking at first, but I got to tell you, I wouldn't change it for the world. Both of those kiddos are unbelievable.
Yeah, they are. They certainly are. I follow the whole journey on Facebook, and it's incredible what you've done for them and they've done for themselves and you've done for the community. So
thank you.
It's tough to get a diagnosis of any kind is tough. And then to have that, hanging over their heads, I know years ago, I have a family member with, that's on the spectrum and it was hard, having that label. And so I always worry about that with my children. If they're ever diagnosed with something, are they going to have that label? Where's the support going to come from?
Right.
Are they going to be ridiculed? Are they going to be able to succeed? How is that going to play out?
Right.
But having the diagnosis probably for you was maybe a breath of fresh air after you mourn, because then it's like, okay, I know what to do now.
Right.
You're not guessing.
Right. And now I have access to resources I never had before, just having that diagnosis. So there is a plus side of having a diagnosis, there also is some negative sides of it, because it will follow both of them around for the rest of their lives. And some people put labels and limits to having diagnoses when there's actually no limits at all for any one of our kids.
Everybody has a diagnosis of something. Yeah. I mean, let's get real. Probably. Right. Not 100% statistically, but everybody has something they deal with.
Right. Everybody has a little quirkiness inside.
And that's what makes them who they are.
And the world would be no fun if we were all exactly robots.
Exactly the same.
It makes my world is extremely, extremely delightful every single day. And I know that sounds cheesy. It is hard. Don't get me wrong. Mm-hmm. Having both for them, I'm sure having autism is hard, but having children with autism is also very hard. But at the same time, every day we are laughing. There is not a day goes by that we don't laugh. So I'm very blessed to have both of them at whatever abilities they are at the time. And it's fun. It is a good time. It's hard, but it's a good time.
And then how is autism diagnosed?
Oh, that's a good question. So it's a neurological disorder. At VCU, they literally study behaviors. So they'll bring with Danny, they brought him in. They watched him. They watched him play. They watched him play with peers. They watched him look at things. And a lot of... there's a big, huge social component to an autism diagnosis. If somebody is in a room full of children, normally a group of children will gather together and start interacting and this, that, and the other. Maybe sometimes a child with autism will absolutely not want to be anywhere near them, and they will be very hyper-focused on themselves. Mm-hmm. And that's okay, because that's where their comfort zone is. And then there's things like sensory overload, which... I mean, a lot of people have sensory overload. There are ways to look at genetics to see what genes are doing and how they're interacting and how they're affecting people's bodies. They also go through a mental health segment of testing. So there are literally dozens of tests that they run in order to diagnose. So because it is a pretty significant diagnosis, they do as much research as possible before they have to label somebody with that. But VCU is where we went, and you can also get an educational diagnosis also. So mm-hmm. if a student or a child is struggling, they have people coming into the schools or have somebody already on staff that can do some, it takes months, but be a diagnostician and watch a student to see how things are playing out. So you can get an educational diagnosis too. But it's a very long, lengthy process, but we've got great resources now. 20 years ago, maybe not so much, but now we have a lot of great resources for that sort of stuff.
And I honestly feel like a lot of that in Fredericksburg is because of you.
Oh.
I always have questions about spectrum or whatever, I call you. You're my encyclopedia.
Oh, well, I happen to have a good network of people. I definitely don't know all of the answers, but I know somebody who might. Mm-hmm. So, and I'm very much I appreciate that because I'm an information junkie. Yeah. I just love information. So if I don't know the answer, I want to learn it and somebody else I can find out the information from. So I appreciate that. Is very kind of you to say that.
It's only facts.
So. Oh, thank you. Thank you.
And then is autism genetic?
So they don't know. What they do see is statistically speaking, if one person in your family has autism, statistically, you will have somebody else or a lineage of. But it's not, that is definitely not a ground rule for anything. They're not sure. They still don't know. There's speculation of having to do with vaccines at younger ages, having to do with in utero, what kind of vitamins a mom is taking. Whatever it is, they still don't know. But some people say that our brains are evolving into having superhero and superpower brains.
Oh, I would
love that. And that is why there's autism. So we really, at this point, they're still studying and they're still making a lot of research, doing a lot of research about it. So we don't know, unfortunately.
I mean, Superman was a foster child.
Right. I mean, I think we could all be a little more Superman-ish. I definitely, yes. A little more quirky, but it makes the world a little bit more fun.
It does. And it gives everyone confidence.
Yeah, it really does.
It's always fun to put on, I know for my kids, to put on a mask and a cape and feel like you can take over the world.
Yeah. Yeah. I keep seeing like memes around because yesterday sometime this week was like National Women's Day or something. Yeah. And I keep seeing these memes of superhero women and
we should wearing their capes on
today. I should have worn a mask.
Next time,
an eye mask
we're going to have cooking autism capes and masks, and it's going to be super fun.
Yes, it gives you strength and confidence.
So the rate of autism, it's climbing. Is that correct?
Well, yes, we have. We've seen, I think, over the last 10 or 20 years that it went from being 1 in 1,000 to 1 in 208 or something, down to 100 to 1 in 100. And now we're looking at a rate of about 1 out of every 54. We don't know. The guidelines, the umbrella for autism has changed over the years. So it used to look a lot different from now. They've changed it in this big, huge medical book of what falls under that umbrella. So not only has that changed, but like they said, we were talking just a minute ago about what could be happening. There also could be an environmental component. Mm-hmm. So, but what we are seeing is that it is about 1 in every 54 at this point, according to the CDC, of children that are born with it. But if you...
Can they be diagnosed when they're born, or does it have to...
It usually... So I'll backtrack into my oldest son. My oldest son, he is extremely intelligent, he's always been very verbal, and he started walking very, very young. We started noticing some red flags, if you will, of autism back when he was around a year and a half. He was tippy-toeing, extreme sensory overload, lining up his toys, not playing with his toys the way they're intended. So like a truck, some kiddos would just roll, not him. He would try to like look at it and manipulate it, take it apart. So we took him to the pediatrician and said, hey, man, he's tippy-toe walking. He's got some like flapping of his hands. And they said, oh, he's just young. They try not to diagnose. They try not to really focus on autism until usually about a year and a half. And most doctors are a little nervous to diagnose autism until ages 2.5 to 3. Mm-hmm. So, but I'll tell you, with my other son, Danny, a family member came over and said, hey, he's not looking at me in the eyes. He seems to be oversensitive. He's hypersensitive to things. And he was only less than a year old. He's not talking. So they don't really diagnose autism at birth, but over time, you start to see some developmental delays. So most doctors, and I won't say all doctors, but most doctors are a little nervous to diagnose it before the ages of like 2, 2.5, 3.
And have you ever seen where it goes undiagnosed for years and then you're an adult and you're like, there's something different about me, but I don't know what it is?
Absolutely. We're there's this amazing, amazing woman over in Michigan that we've been helping with because she's starting a new nonprofit for her autism. Her name is Moonlight, mm-hmm. and she is, I believe she said she's about 26 years old, and she wasn't diagnosed until last year. She knew that she felt out of place, sensory overload, a lot of quirkiness. She knew she didn't really feel like... So in autism with some women, they're able to, what do they call, masking. So they look at a person and they do what that person is doing in order to mask their own symptoms of autism. So let's say there's a bunch of girls hanging out playing Barbie dolls together. They will watch them and try to figure out how to mimic that behavior so that they can fit into the group so they don't feel out of place with friends. Yeah. So a lot of women with on the autism spectrum, they learn very quickly how to do that masking. So she must have been masking when she was an adult or younger, moving into adult. But it is very common for women to get undiagnosed until later into their adult years. Very common.
Wow. What about men?
Men, statistically speaking, according to the medical field, males get diagnosed significantly more than women. That they think that there's more men on the autism spectrum than women because of the fact that women can mask so well. So if you're looking at the research, I think it's out of the 54, I want to say more than 70% of them are male. So it's hard to know because you don't know what you don't know, you know. Mm-hmm. if you don't feel right and you just know that you've never really fit in, you don't fit into the cookie cutter of what everybody else is doing, you don't know what it's like to be on the other side where it's just easy peasy. Mm-hmm. So it's a good question.
Yeah.
And so you support the community a lot. So how can the community support you? How are you funded? Do you take donations?
Yes, of course. So we have, we always have events going. You can always email april@cookingautism.org or go to our website, cookingautism.org, to make donations. We are constantly in the search for sponsors. We have a big autism event and race and festival coming up in October. We have, we're currently raffling off a car with three other nonprofits that are amazing. We could always use financial help because unfortunately it takes money to support our kiddos. I wish it was a free mm-hmm. thing. But yes, cookingautism.org is the best place to find us.
Okay. And then April is April is Autism Awareness Month.
Yes!
There we go.
Yes. Yeah.
And so how are you celebrating?
Okay. So this year we are going to be, well, first of all, the YMCA is raffling off a car to support Cooking Autism, which is amazing. And actually three other nonprofits in the area, which is fantastic.
Yeah.
We are going to be doing a boatload of really fun cooking events for our kiddos in the area that would like that support. Mm-hmm. And we always do kind of a big Facebook push for Autism Awareness Month to gain funds to help us support our students for an entire year. So this year we are looking at almost 600 children that have this program for an entire year because of things like our Facebook fundraisers and stuff like that. So we always celebrate. We go big in April, Autism Awareness Month. And I have to say March 21st is Down Syndrome Awareness, National Down Syndrome Awareness Day. And so we like to celebrate that too. And what we do for that one is we put our we wear funky socks and mismatched socks, and we make a big deal out of it too. So those are our two funnest parts of the year. But on top of that, in the month of April, we are giving away more grants to programs to help support them during at least a half a year to provide more support to other children in the area, the ones that we haven't been able to reach yet. So we always have fundraisers and stuff like that going, but it's very important for us to be able to give back. And we are giving a a scholarship in May. We'll be giving out a scholarship to a local student in the area. So there's always so much happening.
You do so much. Yep.
Yeah. It's fantastic, though. I wouldn't change it. It's really
Again,
great.
I should have brought your cape.
Yeah. Yeah, thank you.
So if somebody is listening today, you know, say a mom is listening or a dad, and they think that their child might have autism, what are some, like, telltale signs that they could, you know, maybe start watching for?
Sure. So from personal experience, things that are just seem a little bit quirky. I like to use the word quirky because there's nothing wrong with being a little quirky. Mm-hmm. Things like lining up your toys, but becoming overly excited about if somebody would come and move that toy. So my kiddos would line up their toys, and if I would come over and just misplace one of them, oh boy, the world had ended. Mm-hmm. Tippy toe walking. That's usually a sign, because what's happening when a child is walking on their tippy toes, what's happening is they're looking for a different viewpoint. Something is not settling right, so they're looking, it changes the way their brain is looking at something. Yes, it's so cool the way their brains work. Mm-hmm. If they're not crawling, if they're not walking, if they're not talking, if you're noticing that they just don't want to have any interest in hanging out with anybody, they just don't have that interest to connect, that is very normal. And it's not that they're being selfish. It is just their defense mechanism, because the world is very stimulating. If there is something called elopement, if they're walking out the front door and not realizing that there's danger out there, or trying to get in, there's some scary components to autism. So they have a whole bunch of this information at the VCU website, and the VCU Autism for Excellence program has literally hundreds of podcasts that you can go and listen to, and resources as a first-time parent or trying to understand what autism looked like. So they have done a phenomenal job, and most of them are run by doctors and educators. So
you did a lot of that, of researching and wrapping your brain around what was going on, mm-hmm. and being able to cope with it.
That is right. I honestly didn't know anything about autism at all, mm-hmm. before around the time that my son got diagnosed. No idea anything about it.
But so scary.
It was so a little scary. But I also, if you think that your kiddo might have autism, I also have to tell you that you are not alone, mm-hmm. and that there are so many amazing resources. After you get a diagnosis, it kind of opens up your world to resources, and not only in this area, but around the world, and the mm-hmm. support groups, and just tools to be able to help your child. So it's hard, don't get me wrong, but totally worth it. And and they can always reach out to me, april@cookingautism.org, and I can probably help them get some resources as well.
And if someone wanted to be in your program, you said you have, what, 60 kids?
Yeah, 600 kids.
600 kids. Oh, my goodness. 600 kids. So how much is it for each kid?
So
so if someone's donating, they can say, oh, well, I want to fund this one child for a whole year.
Right. Whatnot. So our kiddos never, and our families never pay anything. And that was super important for us as a nonprofit. We never, ever, ever want any money to come out of a parent's pockets for this.
Especially when they're going through.
There's so much to do already. So much. So $56 is usually the only thing it costs for one student for an entire year.
Wow.
$56. I mean, very manageable, because we are able to do it in a larger setting. If we had to do it in smaller settings, it'd be a little bit... and I say large, but large is 8 kiddos. If we could do it in a 2 or 3 person setting, it would be a little bit different. But $56, it's all it takes for one person for an entire year.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Wow. That is not a lot.
No, it's not bad at all.
Yeah.
Not bad.
No, certainly. So just reiterate to the listeners where they can find you if somebody is listening.
Yeah.
And then I'm going to throw out a final question that I ask all of our guests.
Okay. cookingautism.org is our website, but my email is april@cookingautism.org. You are welcome to contact us anytime. And then, of course, we have a Facebook page with, you'll find us at Cooking Autism on Facebook as well.
Yeah. So this is, you know, obviously sponsored between the Pohanka dealership yes. and UMFS. Mm-hmm. And so at UMFS, we, our kids, our families, our staff, we view them all as unwavering champions.
Yes.
So how do you think you're an unwavering champion in the community?
Oh, my goodness. That's a hard question. I just want to provide support. So if that means that I'm an unwavering champion, then I will take that title for sure. My heart is for other people to have the support that my family has come to receive. So my kiddo having that life skills program before Cooking Autism was even available, I saw the amazing, amazing difference it made. And then the group of people that surrounded me to lift me up when my kiddo got diagnosed. My heart is that anybody that has a family member with a diagnosis has the resources that they need in order to have success for their family and for that young individual. So if that means, if me working to help provide that, if that means I'm waving unwavering champion, then I will take it.
Yeah, I would certainly say you are. Okay. Time and time again.
Thank you.
Oh, April, it was so nice to have you
Thank
here.
You.
I really, really appreciate it. For those that are listening, this is April Burch with Cooking Autism, Inc. And of course, my name is Angela Rivers with Fredericksburg Mission. If you're also looking to become a foster parent, you can reach out to umfs.org/foster. Thanks. See you next time.
Thank you.
Bye. Bye. Thank you for joining us. I'm Angela Rivers with Fredericksburg Mission. Tune in at Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or anywhere you listen to your podcast. Join us again next week for our next episode.